They are people too. That's one of the more fortunate things I've been able to discover, rubbing shoulders with some pretty outstanding people, is although they may achieve great things, they're largely people just like the rest of us.
This is true. This is absolutely true.
Gives me hope.
No, I know you've accomplished many great things. Hello everyone, welcome to Everything Band, a podcast that features conversations with composers, conductors, and performers of music for winds and percussion. My name is Mark Connor, I'm a composer, and this is episode number 33. My guest for this episode is Joe Allison. Before we begin, I'd like to thank all of you for listening and for your support. If you find value from the show and haven't already done so, please leave me a rating on iTunes. You can also follow the podcast on Facebook, Twitter, and Instagram, and if you're really loving what you hear, you can support me on Patreon at patreon.com/MarkJConnor. Now, on to the episode. Hi, Joe.
How are you, Mark? I'm thrilled to be here with you today.
Oh, well, thank you so much. I'm really happy you could join me. You were recommended to me by Blair Smith first.
Oh, Blair's, he's a wonderful young man. I still consider him a young man, even though he just recently retired from his high school job. He's younger than me, but that makes the playing field pretty large, doesn't it?
So can you introduce yourself, Joe, and tell the listeners who you are and what you're doing right now?
Well, I'm currently on the faculty of the School of Music at Eastern Kentucky University, where I was director of bands for 14 years. And now I am the director of outreach and music research. I have a research group that does a lot of projects, particularly in the marching arts, in the last few years through the auspices of that research team and also the Marching Roundtable podcast series, which, Mark, you may be familiar with. We do a lot of things to try to tie the marching pageantry world, particularly in the public schools, into the general music curriculum, particularly of instrumental studies. So all that keeps me fairly busy.
Yeah, I bet it does. So let's talk about the Marching Roundtable while it's sort of at the front of the conversation here.
Okay.
What is that podcast, and what could my listeners possibly who don't know about it get from that?
Well, about 5.5 years ago, Tim Hinton, Mary Williams, and myself, along with John Bogenschutz, decided we wanted to start some sort of dialogue in the band activity that included the marching arts, because in so many situations, we felt like that the marching bands were becoming more and more autonomous from the regular school curriculum, and that's something that we found problematic. So we decided to start this podcast series. And 5.5 years later, it's in the mid-600s and has a wide base of listeners, and we've really enjoyed this process very much.
Yeah, I look at your episode number, and I look at 600, and I kind of wilt a little bit, having done 33 and thinking, wow, that's a lot of episodes.
Well, it is. There are multiples of us, although Tim Hinton is the quarterback of the whole thing and generally the host of the podcasts, and I think he's been involved in almost every one of those, but we feel like it's a labor of love. And truthfully, we feel like in synergy with my research team at EKU that we've been able to affect some fairly important changes in the community. And so we're really happy about it.
Yeah. Yeah. Well, it's a good show. I really enjoy it. I'm not much of a marching arts kind of guy. It's been a long time since I marched myself. I won't say how many years that's been. And I'm sort of more of a concert band and composer. And so I'm curious from your perspective, and maybe I'm overgeneralizing, but it seems that when I was young going to college, it seemed like the marching program grew out of the concert program. And maybe, as you mentioned earlier, maybe that's flipped in the last couple of decades.
Well, I'd like to think that it hasn't completely inverted itself, but there are situations. I mean, the marching band for most schools is their most public face.
Sure.
That tends to be the funding and the emphasis tends to go through that part of the program, maybe to a greater degree than other parts of the program. And I know I was a high school band director for 20 years, and I had to work very diligently to make sure that everything came from the core of the curriculum, which is the concert band. That's very strongly our opinion in the Marching Roundtable. And so we try to sort of figure out a way to help lead people down that circuitous path that it takes to do both and do both well. Because the truth of the matter now is, particularly at the national level of high school marching band competition, your band has to play really, really well. And not just back in the day like it was all brass, but the entire wind ensemble and these really huge complete percussion ensembles have to demonstrate quite a lot of skill in those performances to be successful.
Yeah, absolutely. And you mentioned that marching is the public face. And, you know, I, at this time of year, especially with BOA going on and all the local and regional festivals, our social media feeds are filled with friends and family with trophies and the pictures. And
isn't that the truth?
It sure is. It's inspiring though, because, you know, even though I'm not a marching arts person, this is music education working and hitting the public.
Well, exactly. And if done well, it can be just an incredible advocacy effort and bring people into programs that otherwise may not have been there and allow students to do things that they otherwise wouldn't have done. I know in my own experience, I learned a lot of significant band literature through being in marching band and orchestral literature as well. That activity introduced me to so many staples of the orchestral literature that were transcribed by some of the top groups at the time.
And isn't that true that those orchestral works do get transcribed for marching band a lot more than they do for concert band?
Yeah, it's become quite the thing. And of course, now we're in an age where there's a good bit of oversight relative to copyright statutes and whatnot. But still, it's an avenue by which many of us first encountered some pretty wonderful literature.
Yeah, public domain music too. So the copyright issue is less urgent. So how do you feel about that, about music for the marching arts world? Do you feel that, what direction is it going in as far as actual literature?
Well, we've gone through a couple of phases. Between, you can't talk about high school band, marching band without talking about drum corps as well, because it's sort of two sides of the same coin now. And for audiences aren't familiar, we have these private groups that are part of two organizations. One is Drum Corps International, the other is called Drum Corps Associates. And they tour in the summer and perform in a number of competitions, and they become very, very proficient at what they do. And being in a competitive atmosphere over a period of time, starting back in the 70s, actually, when Drum Corps International was formed in 1972, a lot of these groups started adapting concert band literature, and then that led pretty quickly into staples of the orchestral library to use on the field, on the march, for their competitive routines. And as such, the music has over that time become much more sophisticated, to the point where in the late 1990s, we felt like cyclically we got to a point where the music was almost becoming too intellectual and involved to be of appropriate entertainment for an outdoor audience. So now we've sort of reverted, in different groups developed their own brand or personality by doing things like show tunes or major band works or orchestral works. Or there's quite a bit of diversity. And certainly in the last couple of style periods that have occurred, I know a good bit of minimalist or somewhat minimalist, I can't even say it today, techniques have been used, music like John Adams, and different people of that ilk have come into the mix. And it's really introduced our audiences and our performers to a wide range of musical topics.
Sure. It's so ubiquitous now, the DCI and the marching band. But let's just say we have someone maybe who's coming out of maybe an instrumental tradition where they aren't involved in the marching arts and they want to sort of see what this is like and get a sense of this. I guess what I'm thinking about is maybe a music education major who doesn't come from a traditional marching program.
Right. And we definitely have those. And now, as a matter of fact, the joke in music education circles is that Drum Corps has become sort of a graduate school for aspiring band directors, because they can get such an intense experience by joining one of these groups and learning how some of this specialized pedagogy works. But certainly in this particular, we're talking with one another in October. This is right in the middle of what we call marching band season for the schools. And there's lots of, you can Google and find, I'm sure, any number of competitions within your area code at any point in time through the first couple of weeks of November.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah, no question. I'm sorry.
No, and I was going to say, of course, the Drum Corps thing is more over the summer months. That concluded with the DCA championships on Labor Day weekend traditionally.
Mm-hmm. And so you mentioned DCA and then there's DCI. Can you explain the difference for the listeners?
I can. DCI is what we call junior drum corps. They have a maximum of 150 members each. And basically, they're eligible to perform until their 22nd birthday. In Drum Corps Associates, it started out as largely older people, and although they have age limits, I think it's from 15 up, and so there are older adults that participate in it. It's become kind of a younger activity in the past 5 or 10 years because the demands, the physical demands of doing these routines while playing and moving like they do has gotten to be pretty athletic. And so in some ways that activity has become a bit younger. Plus they still have a number of alumni corps where the old guys like me can get back together and play their tunes and reminisce a little bit during the summers.
How do we tie the marching arts to the concert band curriculum? And what is the connection that we need to be more aware of as we teach these things?
That's a great question. I'll see if I can give it a somewhat succinct answer. If the procedures in terms of demands, pedagogy, and whatnot are consistent both indoors and out, the instruments are approached in the same technical and art and artistic way that they are in any ensemble in a program, then the marching aspect of this has great merit for everyone. I like to paraphrase a story that Chris Martin, the principal of the New York Philharmonic and former principal trumpet player of the Chicago Symphony, has been quoted often as saying that he learned how to play his trumpet in lessons, but he learned how to perform in drum corps. And for someone of that ilk to be able to say that, I think that speaks volumes. We do have things in our past, initially when the marching band thing became so popular in high schools, where we sort of divorced the two activities, but it doesn't work very well that way. And I know the most successful programs we see around the country are ones that marching band is simply one component of a comprehensive program that usually contains chamber music, jazz ensembles, but the core of all of it is the sit-down band, as we call it. And none of us ever want to trade that. And as long as we keep our priorities in focus, it's just easy for the tail to wag the dog a little bit because of all the public support you get from the marching band, all the notoriety that you can get from it. But true educators know that that part can't be successful without the basis of the program being intact.
Yeah, I have two thoughts to that. One is here in St. Louis, I just visited Lindbergh High School, which is a very large marching program. Right. And I was really encouraged when he told me his numbers and how they have 300 people in the band program, 300 kids, and only 200 of them are in the marching. And I know that's odd to say only, but that means all the others are in the jazz program, the concert bands, the chamber ensembles. And so that, to me, as someone who's a concert person, was exactly that. It's a program where the focus is on the music rather than that marching program, even though that is the big ticket item.
Exactly.
The other thing I was going to say is I sometimes we see criticism from within the classical music community of marching band. And I think sometimes there's a misunderstanding of what it is and how it interrelates with the rest of the programs.
Well, I think that's definitely true. And I think some people get their opinions about school marching bands by hearing something they heard 30 years ago or seeing a band at a football game. I know those bands have to do quite a lot of things for their schools in addition to their competition. There are even schools now that have a competitive marching band that's a different marching band than their football band, so as to be able, it usually takes a lot of students to be able to provide that kind of service. But the point is the programs that have longevity and are based on quality do exactly that in everything they do. So it's as much a matter of pedagogy as is priorities. But I think we're beginning to do really well with that.
Yeah, I'd agree. All right, Joe, let's change direction here for a moment. And let me ask you about yourself. And so how did you get your musical start?
It's really interesting. I wanted to be in band when I was in elementary school. And at the elementary where I was going, we were excited one spring. The high school band director and some staff came in to test us on the instruments. And I remember they did some things with mouthpieces and different sorts of things and told me they thought I should be a trombone player. So I went home to my parents and said, I want to be in band and I want to play trombone. And basically, to make a long story short, my dad said, I have this cornet that I had and I played in high school, which at the time I never even knew that. And he said, you'll need to play it if you join the band. But of course, as a fifth grader, I didn't want to go around with a not shiny, funky looking cornet that was mostly rusty. So I didn't get in the band at that time. And as a matter of fact, I was in high school. It's really a different sort of story. We had moved to a new part of Knoxville, Tennessee, And a new band director came to that school, and he was like Henry Higgins from The Music Man. He went around to study halls and talked to people and did some on-campus recruiting. And he told me that I could be in the band and play drums. And so I did that. It was really strange. As a matter of fact, I started at the second semester of my freshman year in high school. And with fondness, remember, I marched in what used to be a big thing in Knoxville, the Dogwood Arts Festival Parade, either in March or April, getting to play on my timbales. I had a set of matching timbales that I strapped onto my body and played during that parade. And I thought I was king of the world. But at any rate, he was quite the charismatic guy. And within a couple of years, he had the band from like in the 40s to around 110, I think it was. And I got to be there during the time that Mac Bowman was his name, by the way. I certainly should make sure that I make that public. We lost him to cancer a few years back, but he was a highly successful band director known by many, many people. And we miss him very dearly. But he built a program very quickly and with success that brought success. And I got to watch that from sort of standing behind the band, as it were, in the percussion section. And I decided that's something that, even though I wasn't qualified in the least to think about, I sort of wanted to do it. But I guess better thoughts prevailed, or better judgment prevailed. And when I first graduated from high school, I went to the University of Tennessee and majored in general business, which is as general of a degree program, I guess, I could find. But lo and behold, while I was there, I found out that there was an availability for a scholarship at East Tennessee State University, which is where I graduated undergrad, to go there and work with the marching band, write percussion music, and be the section leader for the percussion section there. So I went there and left UT with sort of middling grades because I wasn't terribly inspired, and truly forgot how much I had missed the band when I got started in again. I just felt like I was in the right place. And that was a wonderful atmosphere for me there during the time, because the program was large enough that we could have any number of ensemble responsibilities and opportunities, but it was small enough that I could get personalized instruction. And as a matter of fact, since the reason I got there was that the percussion studio was vacant for a year, I got to teach in the studio and got to also major in an instrument. So I majored in French horn. And when I graduated, I was able to fulfill a goal of making the top wind ensemble on French horn. And I had a great experience both teaching and learning. And it set me up for my first teaching job, which was with my great friend John Culverhouse. And we taught together at Loudoun, Tennessee, for the high school, middle school, and elementary schools. And it's so funny, later in my career, when I was at some really great situations, people would insinuate that I had never experienced a hard road. I remember that we taught at an elementary school called Steaky Elementary in rural Loudoun County, which is rural in and of itself, on a dirt floor underneath a gymnasium. And yeah, and every basketball season, it was hard to hear the kids play because the dribbling of the basketballs got to be a little bit much. But it was a wonderful situation, and a lot of kids grew to have a great band experience. But I was there for a year and then moved to North Carolina to teach in the Richmond County school systems, where I was assistant band director for a couple of years and then the head band director. And that was a great experience. It was a large program. We had, like, I think it was my last year, 312 kids in the high school band. And from there, I moved to South Carolina and taught at a couple of different school districts, the most notable being the Sumter High School there in central South Carolina. And the claim to fame from that wonderful program was we were in the right place in the right time. We were the first high school to be awarded both the Sudler Flag of Honor for Concert Band Excellence and the Sudler Shield for Marching Band Excellence. And so we're very, very proud of that. The second group was from Tenri, Japan, by the way, to do that. And after that, I had an opportunity. Just one of those strange things came up. I was judging for the East Tennessee State University Concert Festival, Band and Orchestra Festival, the spring of, I guess it was 99. And Jim O'Donnell, who was the wonderful chair of the music department during that time, came to see me at my judging station in the auditorium. And he said, we're looking to fill a position here. Do I know anybody that would want to halftime teach tuba studio and halftime teach the second concert band and help out with some of their ensembles? And I said, well, let me think on this. The truth of the matter is, I said, sort of as an aside, if it weren't for the tuba studio part of it, I'd be interested. And he says, really? And I'm like, yeah. And he says, let's have lunch. Mm-hmm. So we did, and he explained the situation to me. And long story short, I took that job as the associate band director there and did it for 3 or 4 semesters, one of which, while my colleague Paul Hinman went on sabbatical, and really enjoyed it. And so because of that, I decided I would start a doctoral program at the University of South Carolina, where I also did my master's degree. And so for 2 years, I taught in East Tennessee and commuted 2 days a week to South Carolina. I literally wore out a vehicle doing that. But the the people there, William Moody was my supervising professor, and they were so good to me and flexible that I was able to finish that degree up after teaching one more year as an interim at the University of North Carolina at Charlotte, UNCC. And from there, I won an audition to go to be the band director at Eastern Kentucky University, where I did for 14 years, and I'm now still on the faculty there. So it was sort of a circuitous path, but one that's been very valuable to me and hopefully given me a little bit of a worldview, because I know particularly the undergrads that we deal with at Eastern Kentucky have some of the same type of backgrounds that I experienced myself. And I think it gave me a sense of empathy. If nothing else, I could help students not make the same mistakes that I made getting from point A to point Z. So it's been a real labor of love.
Yeah, there's a lot there to talk about, Joe, for sure. I just kind of want to touch back on this idea that, so you started out, you wanted to be a trombonist. Your father wanted you to play the cornet. You ended up starting as a percussionist, but your bachelor's degree in music is in French horn.
Isn't that ridiculous?
And your master's is in percussion.
Yeah. So it's like I'm a master of, what is it? Master of jack of all trades, master of none.
How does that happen? I mean, I guess, what sort of perseverance does it take to enter an undergraduate degree late as a transfer and then learn a whole new instrument to the level to get your bachelor's degree?
Well, you have to work really hard. And I'll admit, I actually did start on the French horn my senior year in high school a little bit, because we had enough percussionists that we could fill out the outdoor band, which meant many more than we probably needed indoors.
Yeah,
so sure. I was given the opportunity to start on the horn and played some horn that last spring in the high school. And it's something that I just kind of took to relatively well. Mm-hmm. And so it was kind of a smooth continuation. Then when I moved to East Tennessee State, and they were sort of in need of members in the horn studio. So it just sort of serendipity, I guess. And I just always enjoyed that sort of thing. So
mm-hmm. So go ahead.
Well, I was just going to say, a lot of us as educators sometimes sort of turn a deaf ear to those sorts of situations when people want to switch. And believe me, as a person that taught younger grades, I've tried to really talk people out of changing instruments until they get a full, at least somewhat of a, you know, legitimate experience with the instrument that they're on. But it does sort of stay in the back of my head that it is possible for students. Placing students on the correct instrument is so much of the battle for their success.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Yeah. I still to this day feel like I should have been a trombone player. I'm a trumpet player.
It's kind of funny because I still do too. Now this is going to get really layered, because I actually got to play trombone in trombone choir in undergrad school for a while. And I think physically of all those instruments, that's probably the one that would be the most natural for me.
Yeah. I've often thought about picking up a euphonium.
Oh, aren't they lovely? They make the greatest sounds in the world.
They are lovely, but I don't know. I still have my trumpet chops and I still want to play it. But
you're a lot more marketable on the trumpet than you would be the euphonium, as you well know.
Well, but I don't really try to play much anymore. You know, my playing is the community band, because I'm a full-time college professor, and that's not what I do. I don't perform for that gig. So
yeah. Isn't it amazing though? I didn't start back in adult band until I had been teaching high school at Sumter at least 4 or 5 years. And just the joy from walking into rehearsal, making your contribution, playing your part, and then getting up and leaving afterwards.
It's awesome.
I mean, most people wouldn't understand that, but it's just, you just get all the good stuff without all the prep and whatnot. So yeah, I strongly encourage anyone to do it that has an inkling of thinking about making that happen again.
Yeah, it's really fun too, you know, because they pass out music and I, you know, it's like, Oh, look, there's one of Robert's pieces, or there's one of Larry Clark's pieces. And it's I know these people. It's sort of right. Like this. I'm like their pet composer in the ensemble. It's funny.
Yeah, right. I totally get that.
It's fun. It's a nice. Yeah.
Yeah. But I think sometimes we as teachers, we get so locked in, conductors in particular, to all the business work around and the preparation that goes into rehearsing and performing, that sometimes we forget what a joy the process is.
Yeah, absolutely. Absolutely. So I want to ask you about this idea of the circuitous path. I have a similar kind of circular path to where I am right now. What do you think the ultimate value is for a band director or a musician who's taken a lot of different sort of sidetracks along the way?
Well, I've sort of already alluded to this term once, but the worldview, just of having more experiences and understanding that different results can come out of the same experiences or vice versa, and having an open mind about the way that we recruit players, the way that we teach them, the goals that we set for them and whatnot. It certainly has helped me. Of course, the thing that I talk to my students, undergrad students and graduates here about constantly is don't be afraid to ask questions. That's one of the reasons, of course, we started the podcast series. It was amazing. The very best people in the business were willing to give their time and their knowledge just by being asked. I'll never forget, early on, we asked Sam Palafian and, Pat Sheridan, I can't remember his name, to do a session on breathing. And I learned as much during that podcast as I learned in any graduate class I ever took.
Yeah.
And they were just thrilled to give out that information, as they've done so wonderfully for the public schools for so many years. But I really do think it's just the way it affects my own perception of what's possible and what isn't possible.
Yeah, sure. So tell me about your programs. And I guess what I'm trying to get at is, if you could look back and distill some of the recipes for success and some of the successes that you had as a director and with your programs, were there common traits that you can put your finger on that you've sort of, what am I trying to say? Are there commonalities to your success in all those places?
Yeah, the first one I think of immediately is the people that were around me. There's so many sayings about surrounding yourselves with smart people that ensure success. And there's so much truth to that. But as I was younger, and I tell my students about this now a great deal, I was a little bit afraid to ask people questions because then they would know what I didn't know.
Yeah. Uh-huh.
I was sort of afraid to bring in guests to work with my students because I was afraid my students would see my shortcomings as well. And of course, what I eventually found out was that the students loved it if you cared enough for them to bring them everything that you can. And I learned as much or more in those sessions as the students did. And again, there's several sayings about that basically all teacher learning is larceny. Everything I know, I've stolen from someone else.
Mm-hmm.
And that's so true. So once I got more active, it seems almost counterintuitive, but in helping other groups and being a clinician and going to things, enrichment activities, development activities outside the classroom, it just helped me immeasurably know the things that I needed to know to help the students. And one, people think this is strange, but one of our bigger associated activities in the Marching Roundtable is our Judges Academy. And we have put together a curriculum, just like a college study curriculum, for people who want to learn how to be assessors or adjudicators in musical performance. And I found that I had opportunities to start doing that slightly earlier because of my association with marching percussion, which during the 70s and 80s underwent such a huge transformation in approach and instrumentation. And that gave me the opportunity to be in on that end of things, that it helped my teaching and the connections in the world, which brought back more knowledge and opportunity for my students, and things just developed much quicker. So now that's one of the motivating reasons for us getting people in their younger career years to start studying this type of thing, because as important as assessment theory is now to the public school classroom, people need to know more about it.
Yeah, sure. Yeah. You know, one of the things that I really harp on a lot in this podcast is the idea of being generous with your time and being open to things, so that it's who you are as a person, and what you give back is what comes back to you as a musician.
And I've certainly learned that by following a lot of my heroes around. They give and give and give, and it's amazing. But
Yeah, and that's what I was going to say. The band world is such a giving place.
It is. And I think a lot of people don't really understand it, because we do, in our history, we do have some competitive activities and always have had. But keeping that in perspective, that's just about raising the bar for the experience and the excellence that our students can perform. And I'm constantly amazed at some of these activities that I go to either consult with or adjudicate, what students can do that I could have never begun to think about doing when I was their age. But yes, just the fact that we've been able to do over 600 podcasts and have the best of the best come in and share core knowledge with people. There's this need that we all feel, particularly in our later years, to give back and to help nurture. And to, in some ways, our arts programs are sort of always on the cusp of being not extinct, but maybe cut back with, you know, these financial problems that we're having now in municipalities and states, that we want to be everyone to be armed with all the knowledge they can to make these things successful.
Yeah, absolutely. So can you tell me a little bit more about the Judges Academy?
I'd be happy to. It sort of started, the KMEA, the Kentucky Music Educators Association, asked me to put together training, a curriculum of training for their judges for their sanctioned marching band events in the fall. And that took a lot of time, but I had actually been working on some things like that. And so I used that as a starting point. And now we have two levels of instruction. The first one, level one, is the foundations of assessment. And then the second level is a practical application to different adjudication systems. But we've had hundreds of people take these courses. We're now affiliated with the Texas UIL. We've done their judges orientation for them for their fall events. We do the official training for the Central States Judges Association, which is the largest private association of pageantry adjudicators in the country. And we've also hooked up with several state MEAs to provide them with information and courses to help with their adjudications. And one of the reasons this is becoming so urgent, in a lot of states now, band directors are being assessed or evaluated at least partially on the results of these assessed music performance assessments that we have. We used to call them concert and marching festivals. And because of that, it's more incumbent on everyone involved to know more about the systems that we use, how they're applied, and what they can and can't measure, quite frankly.
Is this only for marching, or do you do concert band judging as well?
It started in marching, but now it's expanded into other pageantry groups, and we're in the process of distilling some of this information for use in concert groups. The great majority of the curriculum is cross any kind of medium, because it's all about observing and registering excellence in performance.
Sure. Sure. So what advice would you give maybe someone like me who's been in the music world a long time but isn't involved in judging and maybe would like to do that?
Well, I would suggest that you do, and there's a number of ways to do it. Traditionally, of course, people who have just been successful in these different media have been called upon to adjudicate just because of their expertise. Mm-hmm. It's interesting, though, research tells us that success in playing an instrument does not necessarily mean success in terms of the assessment qualities that are needed to be able to accurately measure the behaviors. And I think we all know of outstanding players who were never very good at teaching their instruments because it came so natural to them. They couldn't exactly understand why anybody. I remember there was a legendary jazz trombonist, one of the first clinics I went to, and he got frustrated because someone asked him how to do a particular technique, and he showed it. He demonstrated it, and he said, "There it is." He said, "Yeah, but how do you do that?" And the guy was like, "Didn't you see me? I just did it." Rather than thinking about the component responsibilities, he probably was just able naturally to make that happen. So we see that a good bit. But nevertheless, there is somewhat of a correlation. But you can contact the local MEA or Band Directors Association. You can contact us at Marching Roundtable, because one of the things we do, we have a judges registry, as a matter of fact, so that people from any part of the country can log on to the registry and find qualified people to work at their particular events and whatnot.
Yeah, this is interesting. I was just having this conversation with someone, and it was in regard to not something musical, but I've been teaching a long time and I've been teaching music, but you can definitely tell in the activity I'm thinking of the people who aren't naturally good teachers.
Right.
And there is a skill to teaching and judging that isn't necessarily the same as performing something. And that's clearly true. What do you think are those teaching skills? What are those most important basic skills of a good teacher?
Well, I think it's a very fundamental thing. First of all, persistence. Mm-hmm. The best teachers I know just set the bar high and keep it high and support their students and push their students in a way that's positive, but definitely rewarding to reach a level of excellence. Thank goodness, early in my teaching career, I found that it was just, if you're willing to roll up your sleeves and really dig in and help each individual student as much as you can, then generally speaking, you can be successful. It's just so easy to get frustrated as a teacher early on if the progress, I know I was always not the best at noticing subtle incremental improvement in ensembles from a day-to-day basis. And so when I would have people come in and say, boy, the band's so much better than it was last March, and I'd be like, are you serious? So it's hard to keep objective when you're in the middle of that. But I just think it's all about the attitude that you convey. You've heard all the sayings about the students don't care what you know until they know that you care.
Yeah, absolutely.
Those things are true. And
of course,
I just feel like it's just constant giving, constant attention, always setting the bar high and just being insistent. Mm-hmm.
How did you fight complacency in that?
Oh my goodness. Wow. That doesn't even register because, well, I just finished, like I told you, when I finished my undergrad degree, the first thing I had to do my second year out, actually, was I stood in front of a class of beginning seventh graders, 130 of them in one room, woodwinds, brass, and percussion. How we got through that year, I'll never know. It felt like I spent half my time teaching and half my time preparing to teach. So complacency, I just can't imagine. It's like the analogy of peeling an onion. Every layer you peel, there's another one under it. And I don't know. It just, in some ways, nothing ever was good enough. But now you have to be careful how you approach that or else you'll frustrate your students. But there was always another level of achievement to be had and goals could be set higher.
Yeah, I think, you know, that belief that there's always something better, there's always room for growth. And that demand of excellence, that really stands out among the most successful people I've interviewed.
Yeah, it does. And the other thing is that I've shared that story with any number of people, and they tend to be easily frustrated as well in some ways, but always have their method of grounding, either a spouse that understands or a good professional friend that, you know, that continues to provide encouragement.
Yeah, absolutely. You know, I'm thinking about your comment earlier about surrounding yourself with good people. One of my guests on the show was Andrew Hitz, the tuba player. Do you know Andrew?
Right. Sure.
Andrew has a podcast called The Entrepreneurial Musician. And one of the things he likes to say is that you don't get on the bus and drive to where you want to go and pick people up along the way. You pick the people that you want to have on the bus with you before you start your journey. And I think that's really, really important.
Yeah, I think that's correct too, because no one can know everything that needs to be known to do all this. And with the numbers that we deal with in band programs, you can't do it all alone anyway. So the more help and assistance that you can get, the better of a culture it establishes for learning and excellence.
Yeah. So how do you thoughts about that? Because when I taught, I was the lone band director. I had a 7-12 program and I had less than 100 kids at when I left. But do you have any advice for those programs? Because there are many of those around the country.
Well, there are, and you have to just network as best you can, because I've been in a couple of situations that felt pretty geographically challenged as well.
I like that language, geographically challenged.
Yeah, it sounds like a euphemism. I didn't mean for it to be that much of one. But at any rate, and just seek out people, whoever the band director is in the next town, or if there's a music school or whatnot, and just sort of beat the bushes. To sometimes people come out of the strangest circumstances that can be very valuable.
Yeah, the people that helped me the most, I immediately volunteered to be on the California. It was the CMEA Regional uh-huh. Board of Directors, and immediately those people helped me.
Yeah,
you know, I'll never forget one of the older board members just helped me find old used instruments, and because I was starting a program from scratch, and just really helped me with those little things that I had no clue about.
Right. And it's just amazing the universality of that. People really want to see music programs succeed.
Mm-hmm. It's true. It's true. A rising tide lifts all boats.
I like that.
So we're quite a ways into this interview, and I haven't asked you about composers and commissions, and I'm sure you've been a part of many of them, but do you have one experience with a composer that maybe you want to talk about?
Well, I think I'll talk about my first one. Years ago, we commissioned Jared Spears from Arkansas State to do a composition for us while I was at Greenwood High School in South Carolina. And what was so much fun about it was the collaborative process, because he sent materials before the work was completed for us to look at and for the kids to get familiar and whatnot. And we felt like, whether true or not, we really did have some input into the work. And for our students, well, I think they were like me. I always thought of a composer when I was in high school band as some dead guy from Europe 150 years ago. And so it really humanized the process.
Yeah, absolutely. And that's what I would hope it would do. You know, I as a composer, I love going into the schools and having the kids like sort of see me as a person who, you know, wrote the music on their stand. I think that makes it a more urgent and more vital, vibrant kind of activity.
Well, actually, it's very true. And although it seemed a little bit expensive to us at the time, it wasn't really that expensive. That positive experience that we had allowed us to do a couple of more commissions during that time. And it was just so invaluable. The community takes a great pride in that. There's something about contributing to the literature that is certainly worthwhile, but just gave our students more insight into the basis and creation of music.
Mm-hmm. Go ahead.
Maybe that they just hadn't considered it more. I know for a lot of players, although I try to get them out of it, it's like, okay, put in front of me what you want me to play, and I'll play it as best as you want. And then that's how the process ends, rather than really internalizing and, you know, getting some sort of ownership out of the process.
Yeah, sure. Sure. All right, Joe. So we've been going for a while now. And so I'm going to kind of go into my final group of questions, if that's okay with you.
Okay. It's been fun.
It has been fun. And there's so much I want to ask you, but I feel like, you know, I don't want to go too long here. Maybe we can revisit it at some point. But, you know, you've given a lot of advice, but is there one more thing, one hard-earned bit of advice that you'd like to pass on to maybe young directors in their first or second year of teaching?
Yeah, that you can't know everything that you need to know to succeed. That if you give your best and most sincere efforts, and students really do pick up on it when we're insecure about what we're saying or we're not sure we're trying to fake our way through something, they can accept the fact that you don't know, particularly if you say, well, I'm not sure about that. Let me contact my own teachers or whatnot, and I'll get back to you. That presents to them a very much more realized picture of yourself than someone who's just not quite confident and trying to do anything they can to make the moment go away. Because again, it's, you just can't know everything that you need to know, and your efforts, your openness for the students, that'll pay many more dividends than just trying to be perfect.
Yeah, absolutely. How do you feel about honesty in the classroom about the teaching process? Like, do you ever find yourself narrating why you do something?
Well, that's something that I try more and more to do, particularly at the college level.
Yeah, sure.
It's just not enough to tell them what they need to do, but they need to know why, because they're going to have to apply that knowledge in their own teaching situations in many cases. But I think you can be too candid sometimes, but it's you just don't get away with telling untruths, even if you wanted to. It always comes back to haunt you. So I think that there's really not much of a recourse other than be as benevolently honest as possible.
Yeah, I'll often tell my college students, if I don't quite have the answer, I'll often frame it as, well, I'm just speculating that this is why it is, but I can find out if you need it. That tends to be my default.
Yeah, and I would respect that as a student, very much so.
Yeah, I think so. Okay, Joe, so what do you think are the challenges facing music education or the band world as we move forward into the 21st century?
Being able to do everything that's being, if not required, suggested, particularly at the high school band level. So many different activities to choose from and whatnot that you have to be able to set your goals based on your resources. The same could certainly be said for the younger grades, as in some cases budgets are tightening and whatnot. But actually, in the interest of full disclosure, my great friend Bob Morrison, who's the head of Quadrant Research in New Jersey, who is a big nationwide advocate for arts and instrumental music program says that the funding thing has actually turned around relatively well over the last few years. But to continue to advocate for your groups, one of the responsibilities that I wanted to perhaps not do very much when I first started teaching was communicate to the public. But if you communicate to first your own public, which is your families in the program, and let everyone buy into what's going on and understands the nature of what you're doing and that it goes so far beyond the classroom, that can be of huge help to you. So I know communication is key in most any project of this nature, but the more and more often you can communicate with the different aspects of your program, the better off everyone's going to be.
Right. Yeah, I agree with that. So Joe, what advice would you give to your younger self? Maybe the 20-year-old Joe.
You don't know as much as you think you do, but other people do. Although it didn't take me long. I tell the story, and I think it's sort of universal. I knew more than I was ever going to know the rest of my life, my senior year in undergrad school. And by the time I had taught 1 year, I knew less.
Yeah, I often tell my students, it's the longer you're in school, the less you know.
Yeah.
By the time I left my doctorate, I was a shivering wreck of insecurity.
Oh, boy. Did you have the dream I had for about 6 months that they were going to take your degree away from you because they found something you were remiss?
I still have that dream. I told this on the podcast in another episode. I don't remember who I was talking to, but the morning I recorded that episode, I woke up and I from a dream, and I was in a panic because I thought that someone had found me out and was claiming, look, he's a fraud. He's a fraud.
Yeah, exactly.
So I don't know if that'll ever go away for me, but you know, you just have to believe.
I think there is a statute of limitation.
Yeah, perhaps. Perhaps I'm just not there yet.
I don't know. Just in having conversations like this, when I have them with students, I feel like I tell them all these things that could possibly be discouraging. But at the end of it, I say, but I promise it's all worth it.
Yeah, no, it definitely is worth it for sure.
But I for one, since I've made this declaration on your program, I'm happy to help students in any way I can at any time I can. There's this wonderful event that's coming up. I think it's the 14th of November in conjunction with the Bands of America Grand National Championship, where Fran Kick and NAFME put together what's called the Future Musicators Experience. They do that also in Indianapolis for DCI finals in August. And they bring in all these college students. And then we have roundtable discussions about things that they may not have learned in their undergrad curriculum and discussing just questions that they have. And we are always supposed to be armed with one thing that we wish someone had taught us in undergrad school that they didn't. And it's such a positive thing. And you get such a wide variety of questions that make you forget sometimes when you're toward the end of your career, what you faced at the beginning of your career that you no longer have to deal with.
Well, that's definitely true. Yeah. Yeah. Early career anxiety and mid-career anxiety and the end of your career anxieties are all different, I suppose, in their own way.
Yeah. For the most part, it's true.
So Joe, I used to ask my guests what their favorite work for Wind Ensemble was, but I found that I get better answers when I ask, what would be the last work you'd like to conduct if that were possible to pin down?
Wow. Well, I would imagine it would be the same answer as probably my favorite piece of music, which is the Bartok Concerto for Orchestra. I own like 6 recordings of it, and I hear it sometimes.
That's a great answer. Do you have a wind band work?
Oh, there's so many. I'm very fond in doing clinics of the Fisher Tull Sketches on a Tudor Psalm, and of course, it has an orchestral history as well. But the importance of that work, the timing of it, the level of artistry of it, and it's not self-evident to high school kids. So I love kind of trying to help them unlock it and see. It's a stunning piece of literature. And there's so many others. I could conduct the Persicetti Symphony from here till next month. You know?
So yeah, I hadn't heard Fisher Tull in a long time.
Yeah, it's wonderful. I finally got to conduct it in the state of Texas. You know, he was quite the Texan. And so I got to do it at a clinic in Dallas last March. And it was one of the highlights for me.
Yeah, one of the great things about that question for me is it reminds me of pieces I want to go either listen to for the first time or re-listen to.
There you go.
Yeah. All right, Joe. So we talked about the Marching Roundtable. We talked about the Judges Academy. And knowing that we're recording this in late October 2017, is there anything that you want to share or promote?
Well, we have a new project coming out that's just recently released, survey that you can find all the major band organizations for sponsoring it, but we're dealing with the issue of amplification and electronics in competitive marching band. That's come quite to a head of late. There's some people that feel like that it's the tail starting to wag the dog in terms of synthesized sounds and whatnot. And so this is geared toward your core audience, which are concert people. It's easy enough to find. You can find it on judgesacademy.com or any of the major band organizations, such as the National Band Association, American Bandmasters Association, NAFME, the ASBDA all have links to this. And we're trying to get the community's input to help move us forward in a pedagogically sound way.
Yeah, well, that's going to come in the concert world as well, whether those pieces are appropriate for judging as well, because it's increasing there is also.
Exactly. That is very true. So it's an exciting new realm, but it needs to certainly be approached with a certain sense of academic reserve.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Yeah, absolutely. All right, Joe, how can people get in touch with you?
Easily enough at joe@ marchingroundtable1word.com or at joe.allison@eku.edu.
All right, Joe, this has been a terrific conversation. I really appreciate your time.
Well, I want to thank you for doing this. Now that we've made this contact, I've had a chance to look over your website, and there are any number of interviews I'm looking forward to doing. And I just, anyone that's willing to give back to the community as you have, I think deserves respect and congratulations for that. So I really appreciate it.
Thanks. It's my goal to do that. I mean, that's why I started it. It was a labor of love in the beginning. So it still is.
And it will continue to be, I'm certain.
Absolutely. All right, Joe, thanks so much.
Thank you.